All right, hi, and welcome to Outside the Lens Social Media and Social Change panel. Feel free to let us know where you're viewing from and in the chat. And let's start. So we are so glad that you could join us today, and we look forward to sharing youth insight, ideas, and connectivity of how we're using social media to share, connect, build audience, and create movement across our channels. First things first, my name is Sienna, and I am an Outside the Lens alumni. I was involved with Outside the Lens as an intern, student, and youth council member, and I'm here to guide us through our conversation today. And a little bit about me is that I'm a freelance photographer. I am the author of a short memoir essay, Broken Pieces. I'm also the creator of the Dear Diaries journal entry. And down the road, I plan to start a foundation to support other homeless youth through the college process, since it's such a complex thing. So, yeah. And this is some of my work that I've, the cover of my memoir, the Dear Diary cover, and then a few pictures that I've taken recently as well. And let me tell you a little bit about Outside the Lens. So the mission for OTL is to amplify youth voices through photography, filmmaking, and digital media, catalyzing change within themselves, their communities, and the world. We put cameras in the hands of youth through our four core program areas, which are cameras in the classroom, cameras in communities, cameras in careers, and cameras across cultures. We work alongside our students, classroom teachers, and community leaders to listen and understand the needs of those who we are working with to create and to co-create innovative, inspiring projects that bring youth voice to the forefront. With that, I am really, really excited to introduce to you our amazing panel today and all who are Outside the Lens students, interns, and now Outside the Lens educators themselves. And first we have Nico, who is from San Diego, California. He is an Outside the Lens Youth Council alumni and is a fashion creator on both TikTok and Instagram. He has a lot of experience from working with brands to studying algorithms and how to go viral. And then here are some of his videos. Alrighty, and next we have Hervoy, who is a director of photography based in Croatia. He has been working in the film industry for about 8 years on a feature, in short films, music videos, and TV commercials. He has been an Outside the Lens intern and also serves as a cinematography mentor at the MFF school and Outside the Lens filmmaking workshops for high school students in Bosnia. He uses social media to share his journey through the film industry while connecting with the wider film community to share knowledge and inspire others to join this special line of work. And here is a short clip of his work. Thank you. Thank you. Now we have Callie, who is a senior at La Jolla High School. Callie has had a passion for the arts since she was 2 years old. From painting to music to photography, she's always turned to creative mediums as a way of expressing her perspective, beliefs, and emotions to the world. She is best known for her portraits, street and travel photography, and her works have been featured by the Museum of Photographic Arts, La Jolla Historical Society, XQ America, and UNICEF, among others. With her free time, she enjoys creating art, running cross country, and playing lacrosse. And then this is some of her portrait photography. Next, we have Devin, who is a junior at Patrick Henry High School. He is an Outside the Lens youth teller architect, working to build and create an innovative youth voice platform by, for, and about youth. He is the founder and president of a photography club at his high school. Devin's interest in photography began in elementary school when he started taking photos with his grandmother at the age of 8. He has won several awards for his work, including San Diego County Fair's 2019 Best in Show for Digital Composite and first place for Best Wildlife from the Central Sierra Environmental Center in the youth category. When he's not behind the lens, Devin plays competitive baseball, volleyball for his high school, and he loves the beach. Now we have Aiden, who is a senior at San Diego Academy. He has been pursuing film and photography since the age of 12 with his first vlog. He is passionate about creating content for his own social media channels and is content creator in OTL's new Youth Tellers program. When he's not behind the lens, Aiden enjoys fishing, surfing, mountain biking, and playing on his high school baseball team. He plans to attend film school to perfect his craft. He is here's some of his work and a short clip from his. Alrighty, so let's dive in and hear from our panelists. Audience, feel free to ask questions to our for our panelists in the Q&A section, and we will try our best to get to them. And so, the first question is a generalized as well. What social media platform is your favorite when it comes to sharing your work with your audience?
I can go first. Me personally, I use Instagram and TikTok avidly. I like sharing my pictures and stuff. I do different like Photoshop edits on Instagram. Mm-hmm. And I find that if I want to kind of take a stronger creative approach, I usually use TikTok because I can also incorporate like sound and stuff. And mm-hmm. that's usually the way I go. If I want to do something like a little bit larger project, a little bit more creative, a little bit longer, and something that usually takes more effort. So TikTok is definitely the best way for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
For me, it's Instagram mainly and Facebook, like an old person, because I usually try to connect with the film industry, and the majority of the film industry is currently on Instagram and Facebook.
Mm-hmm. I also think that's super interesting how like the film community is like now surrounding around Facebook, like you said, but.
Yeah, we have a lot of different filmmaking groups on Facebook, mm-hmm. so it's a great way to connect with others in the industry.
That's really cool. I like that.
Yeah, I would also have to agree. I use Instagram more. I don't really use Facebook. I think Instagram's a great place. You can kind of have all your photos in one spot, mm-hmm. almost like a miniature portfolio, I guess. You can connect with people from all over. Like I have people I don't even know who follow me, comment on my posts. So that's always a cool tool. But yeah, I use TikTok more for, I guess, personal entertainment than it is with putting my art out into the world. But
mm-hmm. It's interesting. Actually, to go off. Oh, sorry.
No, it's okay.
No, I was just going to say like how he mentioned like it's a mini portfolio. I think that's a really cool way of describing like platforms like that. But no,
yeah, that's exactly what I was gonna say. I was gonna say that Instagram is really cool, especially for photographers, because it, you know, when you go to someone's profile, it shows, you know, their work very neatly displayed. You know, it shows their name, and then you scroll down below, and then in a grid form, it shows you all their different photos. And I've actually taken advantage of that. So I really try to show. I mean, I'm not necessarily a photographer, though I do take pride in having a certain aesthetic and a certain look in my feed. And I know a lot of other people do very similar things, and I try to keep a common theme, as do a lot of other photographers or just different content creators. They like to have some sort of theme or aesthetic. And I think that ties together somebody's profile really neatly, like a little bow. And I think it's, I definitely think it's a nice little sprinkle on top.
I like how you say that's a nice little sprinkle. It's true, because a lot of like people's like Instagram definitely reflects like what they're trying to get across in terms of like their creativity and like photography and things like that. But what about you, Aiden and Callie? How do you guys, what's your favorite platform to share and be creative on?
Personally, I use Instagram and YouTube a lot. Therefore, or the reason being is because I'm a filmmaker and I like to post my high quality content on a platform where it can, I guess, show that and display my content. But in the I have also kind of been using TikTok, because TikTok is, as Urboy or Nico has been saying, like it's really easy to build and just grow. However, Instagram is a great way of connecting with people all over the country or and all over the world. So it's just really a mixture of everything, I would say.
Very true. Very, very true. What about you, Callie? Oh, I think she froze.
We may be losing Callie. She had a little bit of a internet issue, I think.
Okay. Okay, well, we can move on to the next question, and hopefully she can join us for that one. But we can start by her voice. What are some of the tools that you are using to make your voice heard and build an audience? And this is also generalized, so whenever you're done, anybody can jump in.
Yeah, I mean, I mostly use Instagram, where I like to share basically my journey through the film industry. Anyone who works in the industry knows how crazy it is and how crazy hard it is to actually become a part of this industry. So, you know, kind of from day one when I first joined the MFF school, which is a workshop that we do in Bosnia and Herzegovina, I've kind of been just sharing, you know, the different behind the scenes photos, and ended up actually growing an audience doing so. And, you know, it involves with a lot of people asking questions and asking like how to become a part of the industry. So that's kind of like the thing that I try to do with my Instagram and social media in general, is just like give on knowledge and advice on how to join the industry. And once you're in the industry, so you know like what you're, what to do actually.
Yeah, that's a good point that you mentioned, like kind of giving that advice and like using it as like, oh, here's some tips how to like share your story or like share what you're trying to get across.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a good point.
Do you mind saying the question again?
Oh, yeah. So what tools are you using to make your voice heard and build an audience?
Okay, yeah. So, I mean, me personally, I really, really, really admire TikTok's algorithm. Because let me give a Instagram for example. It's hard when you put out a post to reach larger groups of audience, because the way Instagram's algorithm works is you need a lot of engagement within the first hour in order to put it on the explore page. However, with Instagram, I mean with TikTok, it's actually very different. So you could have zero followers, a brand new account, and you could post a video, and as long as it's a creative video that people enjoy, it instantly goes out to people who have never seen your account before. And I think that's a really cool different take on a social media. And I think people utilize that heavily to share different types of ideas and different kind of standpoints, because a lot of the different social medias don't have that capability of reaching larger audiences.
Yeah, that is very true. Yeah, it is kind of crazy how like TikTok has like literally just like blown up compared to like Instagram and like Facebook and Snapchat. Like that's where everybody's basically starting to like advocate and like share their work, which I think is also pretty cool. Like you said, like the algorithm is so different between Instagram and TikTok. So it will be interesting to see how they'll evolve within the next few years.
And you could be anybody and just start making videos and just instantly snowball effect and become, you know, have a platform. That's exactly what happened to me. Right. Like I had no prior knowledge or anything. And then I started growing like crazy because I know a lot of other people have as well, because it's just the platform is so different and it's given so many people who don't have a voice and who have never had a voice. And that's why you see a lot of actually social justice and just different kinds of like standpoints, and you see them all on TikTok because you're able to really, really, really share these ideas with a huge group of audience and coming from nowhere. I mean, like I said earlier, you could have zero followers and then make a video and it gets millions of views.
Yeah, that's very true.
Does anybody else? Nico was actually the one who made me download TikTok. And
really?
At first I was like, yeah. He was like, oh, you gotta try this. Like, I grew such a big audience. So I was like, okay, I'll give it a shot. And I posted my first video and I was like, yeah, like, this is just stupid. Mm-hmm. And it ended up getting like 10,000 likes. And I was like, whoa, like this is very interesting.
Yeah, that is really true. I mean, it does blow up really quick. But Callie, you were saying?
So sorry about the technical
It's okay.
Stuff. It's like, it's been crazy. But personally, I like to use Instagram to share my voice. And I think it's a really versatile tool because, you know, there's so many different types of media that you can share on that platform. You have like art, photography, music, video, and I think there's such a large following with Instagram that you can reach basically any community.
Right. No, I agree. And yeah, that's a good point. You can pretty much reach any community on Instagram. Aiden, do you have anything else to add to, or Devin, to what platforms you use to create?
So like I said before, I use Instagram to display like my art, I guess you would say photography. I'm not really trying to gain that big of a following. If I were, I would definitely use TikTok like Nico is speaking of, because like he's been saying, you don't really have to have yourself like established in order to like make it on the app. Like I feel on Instagram, you kind of need to be consistently posting every day, have like a posting schedule. And TikTok, you can post one video and it could get out to millions of people. And so I think it's a great platform for whether it be art or just like personal like comedy stuff like that.
Yeah, that's really true. Aiden, do you have anything to add?
No? I think you go for Devin pretty
much everyone. Okay. So a question from our audience is, and this is a generalized, so do you feel art in do you feel your art influences society? If so, how? And we can start by Aiden.
In a way, well, what my goal in life is to be an influence on society. Later on in life, I personally want to like I want to be a film director, and I want to like start something where I interview locals all across the world and just basically create short films off of people's lifestyles and cultures. I think that's just like an important way of kind of, I guess, showing the world that more recognition of what I guess some people are missing out on. I don't know. I feel like through my lens, which is a film camera or video camera, I feel like that's just a good way of kind of showing people, I don't know, storytelling.
I agree. That is really true about storytelling and like using the lens to kind of just let it take its course, you know, in a way almost. What about you guys? Anybody else?
So I personally have always been like super into the fashion, and I think that fashion is a huge art form because of how many paths you can take it. But one of the biggest things that I really wanted to advocate towards, especially like recently, I've been doing that a lot more. Is more so the fact that like, you know, fashion and style, like you don't need to like other people's thoughts about what you're wearing, like shouldn't matter. It should be whether or not you like it. And, you know, you shouldn't be so malleable to other people's opinions, because you know, style is something that should be unique to each person. Mm-hmm. And I actually had a lot of videos that kind of poke at that and that idea. And I've actually responded to a lot of DMs and comments about that, because a lot of people come to me and ask me, and they're like, oh, like I'm afraid of getting made fun of in school for like dressing different. And boy, right. When I started dressing different when I was in school, I definitely, you know, had my fair share of my friends poking fun at me. But of course, you know, it gets to you, and as does it does yeah. like to everybody else. And so I wanted to make that a very big thing. And so that was the influence that I wanted to have. And since then, since I've started talking about that and having influence and talking to these people and telling them that they just need to be confident and what they're wearing, and know that it's, you know, it's not them that's doing anything wrong. It's the fact that other people are just being negative. And, you know, as time passed, like nobody started to, you know, say anything bad about it, because they realized that, you know, like, also I got to where I am because of the way I dress and because the way that I started to carry myself and be more confident in myself. And since I started talking about all those things, I've had a lot of people come and message me or comment and say that I've inspired them to start, you know, dressing different and, you know, stop wearing like sweatpants every day and like start wearing the jeans that they've wanted to wear and, you know, that kind of thing. So that's definitely the influence mm-hmm. that I have brought, and I'm very happy, and I want to continue to have that influence. But yeah.
Yeah. And I think that's really a good point that you bring in, like how like your style, like clothing should just be your own. And like, I feel like slowly we're kind of breaking down that stigma of like, oh my God, why are you wearing that? You're not supposed to be wearing that. And it's kind of like creating your own identity almost. And that's, I'm glad that you're doing that as well through TikTok. But yeah, anybody else have anything to say?
Adding to what?
Go ahead. Thank you. You know, adding on to that, a large part of my photography and why I started doing it was mm-hmm. to explore my identity, and that has to do with a lot of different aspects, but some are gender, like being female in this mm-hmm. In today's society, and also race and coming to terms with my culture and my ethnicity and where my family came from. Mm-hmm. And I think that through photography, which is seen as this like vehicle of truth, you can explore your identity honestly and truthfully. And by doing so, I hope to connect with people, and I hope to show people that, you know, there's so many different ways that you can figure out who you are, and mm-hmm. photography and all of these, you know, social media platforms and creative ways to express yourselves, you can do that through them.
Right. And like when it's your own, it's like you get to take that like behind the wheel and direct it into like wherever you want it to, and like take its course through it too. So thank you for sharing that. You were going to say something, Herbor?
Yeah, I was just going to touch on what Nico said, you know, about being yourself, because mm-hmm. another thing that I see a lot of like young people making as a mistake is, you know, they might have like this dream of what they want to become in their life, whether it be a filmmaker, musician, or something else. And, you know, society tells them like not to do that, like go get a safe job or something.
Yeah.
And they tend to like suppress those wants that they have. Like that's, for example, something that happened to me, like when I started filmmaking, mm-hmm. you know, I was living in Bosnia and Herzegovina at the time, which is like a third world country. So, you know, everyone there has like this sort of idea that, oh, you get a 9-to-5 job and like you don't go out of like the boundaries or whatever you want to call them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I first started out, I had like a lot of people telling me like, oh, what are you doing? Like, this is not a real career. Like, you can't make money with this, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, what, much like Nico said, like once you stick to that, eventually people just become, you know, accepting of it. It's like they're,
right.
Oh yeah, like Herbo, he's a filmmaker, or, you know, Nico, mm-hmm. he's a guy who dresses that way. And, and yeah, it becomes like a part of you. And, you know, I've, you know, had the privilege to really have an amazing last couple of years, just thanks to the fact that, you know, I stuck to what my dreams were, and, mm-hmm. you know, did what I, you know, became a filmmaker. And yeah, that's like another thing that I really try to do with my social media, is because I have a lot of people, you know, constantly reach out to me. And also when I'm teaching, a lot of students, you know, tell me that their parents either don't support them, or their, you know, friends are making fun of them. And just like trying to get them to understand that, you know, anyone who's achieved anything in life has had those hard times. They've had those moments of doubt. They've had, you know, people doubt them. And, you know, it's all about overcoming that, you know, become mentally stronger by doing so. And yeah, like once you achieve those dreams, all those people who told you that you couldn't do it are, you know, they're going to be telling others how they met you, basically.
I know.
I want to actually add to that.
Okay.
Because it's like, I mean, he's really bringing up something that's really important. Like, we wouldn't be here today if we didn't decide, like, you know what? Like, no, I'm going to keep doing what I like doing. I like doing it. I don't care if you're saying that it's wrong, it's outside the norm, or whatever it is. You know, we wouldn't have the success that we have today if, you know, if we didn't decide that, like, you know, I'm going to keep going and have faith in yourself. And I think that that's where a lot of people get shut down and why a lot of people either, you know, don't take that career path or don't, you know, wear that different piece of clothing because they're afraid of being shut down. And it's that it's the prevailing through that negative scene that gets you to success. And that's how, like, you know, you need to start having faith in yourself. And if you have that good feeling that this is the path that I want to take, then take it, you know. And then that's how, you know, people get successful, because they've decided to prevail through the negative space.
Yeah, and that definitely makes one as an artist or as an individual so much stronger, because it's kind of like you, well, in life, you just got to fall down sometimes and, like, learn and, like, kind of take that step back and put things into perspective to, like, really understand maybe what do you need to improve, or, oh, okay, we got this. And it's, like, to not let that kind of define the rest of our lives almost, or, like, the, you know, who we are in the end of it, because we're growing individuals, we're evolving constantly, and, like, not letting those little small, like, failures almost, like, just stop us from pursuing our dreams and continuing to inspire others through that. But thank you guys for sharing that. And Devin, do you have anything to add about your work and how it's influenced society?
I don't know how I'm going to follow that big message, but
it's okay.
So I don't really have that massive of an influence on social media, but I'd say, like, even on my high school campus, I started a photography club, and I like to get kids to, like, explore whatever art form that be. In this case, it's photography, because you could do so much with it. You could capture just photos of your daily life, pictures of, like, the world around you, or whether you want to have, like, a strong message too. There's just so much you can do with it. So I want to encourage kids to go out and explore that whole idea. Also teach them at the same time of how to make their work better.
Great. Yeah. And
if I can add to that, like, something I see, you know, a lot of, like, also young people, like, do these days, is everyone is striving to be an influencer. But, you know, what we really should be striving for is to be a person of influence. Like, what I mean by that is, you know, Devin,
so well said. He said
yes.
He said, you know, he might not have a big following, but he started a photography club at his school. Like, he's, you know, influencing people in a certain way. Because if you just post, you know, pictures of yourself with, like, I don't know, what you're doing, you're, like, flexing with money, cars, and whatnot, like, and, you know, by, like, social, like, some terms, you're an influencer. But, like, who are you influencing? Like, you're just, like, setting up these unrealistic norms for people. And, like, that's you know, kind of, like, what's that?
You need to stay true to the to the actual word of influence.
Yes.
People just want the following and don't, like, want to have the influence.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what I feel is, like, our responsibility as, like, influencers, to actually, like, stay authentic and, you know, show people, like, something that I started doing is, you know, I'm going to share all my wins with my audience, but I'm also going to share all the hard times, you know, when I'm going through a dark time, or, like, when I don't know, lost a job, a gig or something, like, I'm going to share that stuff and show people that, like, you know, the road to success, and I'm far from successful, but I'm on that road. You know, like, on the path to there's going to be a lot of adversity and there's going to be tough times. And, you know, that's something that we don't see enough of, in my opinion, today.
Yeah.
Is people actually sharing those tough times. Because, you know, it's easy to share the highlights and it's all pretty and fun. But
there's,
you know,
so much,
like,
more
show
to
me.
That.
Exactly. Show me the struggle. Show me what it took you to actually get to those fun times. Like, that's what I want to see. And that's what I think also inspires people to, you know, do more and actually pursue a career
Oh, for sure.
And whatever you can, and you can't get to that, those fun times without the struggle.
Exactly.
The struggle has to happen. You cannot get lost in the struggle and turn around. Once you get through the struggle, it's success. You cannot stop at the struggle.
Yep. Yeah, I completely agree.
Adding on to that. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, no, you can go.
Okay. Adding on to that, people follow you on social media because they want to see you and who you are and your art. And I think that especially nowadays with like social media influencers, there's this pressure to like be the same as everyone else. But the reason why most influencers get more following and are, you know, popular on these platforms is because they're creative and they stay true to who they are. And I strongly believe that creativity comes from like up here and in here. It doesn't come from outside forces and other people. And so by staying true to who you are and showing like, you know, all the good and bad times, I think people can better connect with you and your art.
Yep, I completely agree. And it makes you like more authentic and people can connect with you as like an actual individual, not just this like brand or this logo or like, oh my God, you know, they're just so perfect and things like that. And it's like, no, there's so much more to that to get us to the point where, you know, you're successful and you're doing what you love still. But this has been a great conversation about that question. So I really appreciate you guys just being so honest about it. But we do have another question from our audience, which is a little long. So I'm going to, you know, break it down. It says, as young creatives, are you finding it hard to get to the next level project wise? If not, what are some of the methods you use to secure or improve your work? And then like the rest of it says, one thing a lot of young artists find is that it is hard to convince older people to take it them seriously. Does this affect you? Yeah. And I can repeat it to later if you want.
Yep. That especially the last part.
Yeah, I agree with that more.
In the like, again, in the film industry, especially like where I'm in Croatia.
Yeah.
There's not, like, of course, like they encourage like young people to start in film, but it's really, really hard, almost impossible to break into the actual industry if you're like below 30. Don't ask me how I did it because I have no idea. It just happened. But yeah, like something that's actually like a daily struggle for me is, you know, working with people who have 20 years of experience and then I come on the set and I'm 20 years on this earth. Like, and it's just like, and you know, of course they don't take you seriously. They're like, oh, who's this kid? Like, what's he going to do? Like, why is he here? But you know, like my advice to that is like what has worked for me is just like try to improve your skills to the point where like once you step on that set or that job or like whatever it is, and you actually show people through actions, like, no, it's always that, like, show through actions, not through words. You know, show through your actions like what you're actually capable of and what you can do. And, you know, in my case, like that's what it usually does it, like, you know, once I start working, you're like, oh, okay, like this kid might actually know what he's doing, so I'm not gonna be mean to him or whatever.
I definitely agree to that. I think it's at least right now, it's difficult to get the approval of like older generations, because since this is like, since social media is like very prominent in our generation and not so much like, for example, my parents. It took them a while for them, like, at first they were like, oh, he's just making videos and people following him, whatever. And then it wasn't until like I started, you know, like working with brands and having those emails come in and like, you know, the success and all that, that I started showing my parents. I'm like, look, I'm actually doing something. And then it wasn't until then that they were like, oh, okay, like, you know, maybe he's right, maybe he's actually doing something. And then, you know, it really takes like a slap in the face to really see, like, okay, social media is very real, very prominent in not only like in this generation, but also like in like business wise, it's super prominent. I mean, you see like TikTok is a very new platform, but already you see companies dumping millions of dollars in ads. And then, you know, TikTok just started something called the Creator Fund that they're paying creators now. They got funded nearly $1 billion. I mean, it's really starting to, it's starting to grow like crazy because people are seeing the potential that TikTok has. Even Instagram saw the potential and dropped their own TikTok TikTok-esque thing, called it Reels, and it's very similar to the way TikTok works. You know, people are seeing the power of social media and are wanting to take advantage of it. And I think it's just a little bit slower for older people to see truly the power and change that can happen from social media.
Well, that is very true. Wow, I didn't even know about the fun. That's kind of crazy to think about how, like, TikTok literally from, like, Musical.ly to, like, TikTok, and now everybody's on TikTok.
Oh, yeah.
That's, wow. That is kind of crazy to think about. But, Devin, how do you feel like this might have played into maybe when you started your photography club at your school? Like, were there any challenges that you felt maybe, like, encouraging, like, people at your school, like, teachers? Like, did that, like, influence any of the decision-making into the creation of it?
Not necessarily challenges, and I agree with what everyone else has been saying. Mm-hmm. But I think even to, like, start off, say you want to start off a business, I feel like without social media, you kind of have to, like, know someone that's, like, already in it, that's older. And that's what I like about social media, especially TikTok. You don't need to know someone in order to make it into the business. And I don't think that this whole idea of, like, them not thinking, like, you work hard because you're youth or them, whatever reason it may be, I don't think it just applies to, like, art, too. It applies to, like, a lot of youth issues as well, which is a big thing, too. So.
Yeah, that's very true. Makes me think a lot about, like, how it's also evolved in that, like, idea of, like, we have the potential, and it's just showing people that we can do it regardless of how old we are. I mean, we see little kids doing and, like, taking pictures, these great pictures, and it's, yeah, it's kind of cool to see that. But Aiden, how do you feel about, like, maybe your film work? Has it ever been a challenge to, like, show people, I don't know, like, you know, because of, like, your age and, like, things like that, or, like, as a young creative, are you finding it hard to, like, go to the next level in terms of, like, your film?
Well, kind of piggybacking off of Erboy's idea of the, you have to show your actions, not words. I feel like that really does play a lot in film photography. You can't just, like, say, oh, I'm a great filmmaker. Oh, I'm a great photographer. You have to show your films. You have to show your photography. And that's the only way people are going to be able to evaluate you. However, like, I think that I've been able to really show who I am through the use of my films and the way I storytell and the way I see things. And I think that's kind of my own perspective versus other people have their own perspectives. I think it all just kind of depends on who you are as a person. And yeah, I think that's the same for photography and other medias of art as well.
Adding to that, like, it's all a process. So, like, you're going to have films that you're going to post and people are going to hate, and that's okay. It's just part of the process. But, you know, it's still better to actually make something and then have people hate on it than just talk around, like, oh, yeah, I'm a filmmaker.
Right.
And not actually, you know, have anything to show for yourself.
Right, exactly. And it's kind of like just taking it, you know, just doing it and seeing how people respond to it, and if it's negative like feedback in a way at the beginning, like, that doesn't mean that it's going to define the rest of the project. It's just the stepping, you know, baby steps.
And it's all a learning process. Like, okay, if people hate on it, try to figure out, okay, what is it that they hated about it, you know, improve upon those things.
Right.
And I think it's also, I mean, it's super cheesy, and I agree that it's cheesy. But I think it's cheesy because it's true. And I say that a lot. I say that before I say anything cheesy. It's cheesy because it's true, because people say it so much. And basically, if you don't fail, like, you literally can't succeed. You can't succeed that much. If you don't fail, if people don't like, you need to have that negative feedback. How else are you going to grow? You can't just get, you know, lucky with every turn and then what, you're there, but you only know as far as you can. Like, you don't know the bad things. You don't know, you know, what to avoid. You know, you need that.
I agree.
So I think that I think it's super cheesy, and it's cheesy because it's true. You need the failures. You need the struggle. You know, you need to get knocked down. You need that negative feedback, or else you cannot grow.
Right. Yeah, I was just talking about that in one of my podcast episodes about, like, there's so much stigma around this world, failure, or, you know, you failed, but it's not all that. Like, it's a part of
it's a good
evolving.
Thing too. Failing is a good thing.
Exactly. And it's like you said, those baby steps, and it kind of shows you what do you, okay, what do we got to do differently? And it's not all, you know, bad. But moving on to our next question from our audience, and this is also generalized, so whoever wants to jump in first. If you could change anything with your voice, your work, what would it be?
I don't know. I would change anything. I think I would. I don't know. I don't think I would change anything. I feel pretty like happy with the direction that I'm going. Because the initial thing that would jump out at me would be to like go back in time and like do something differently. But I would want to know that I like. Does that make sense? Like I would want to know. I would want to have. I wouldn't want to go back in time and like avoid that like fall. I needed that, you know, like when you see what I'm saying? Like I wouldn't be where I am if I didn't, you know, fall. So I don't think I would change anything.
Quick clarification. I should have said, I just was told. In terms of change, change in the world, like if there's anything you could change, yeah. It took me a second. It's okay. We're working through that question. Yeah, if there's anything you could change, I guess, within like the world and like using your voice and like what would it be? You could take a second to think about it too.
I think I would change like the stigma around like Asian stereotypes. Because my whole life I've been told that I need to get straight A's and be a doctor and be good at math and science and be horrible at sports. And I think this pressure really influenced me when I was little because I mean, now I play lacrosse, I run cross country. My favorite subjects in school are English and history, not math and science. And I love art. And I think society's pressure on people of my color, you know, really negatively influences us because I hate boxes and I hate labels. And so to be put into one by, you know, my classmates when I was in kindergarten, it was horrible. And I think through my photography, I hope to, you know, reveal like the truth about who we are and that, you know, stereotypes, they shouldn't be there.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Thank you for sharing that with us too.
I think if I were to change anything, it would probably be to like normalize taking different paths that, you know, there isn't just like one, two or three different directions you can go. Like, you know, if you have an idea and you have a path that you want to take, I think it should be normal to take that path and normal to receive support for taking that path.
Yeah.
So that's one thing that I want. And I think if it became a normalized thing, we'd see a way bigger spectrum of people and, you know, of just different career paths in general, because, you know, people feel so pressured to follow what their father did. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Much like what Nico said, you know, trying to show people that you really can do anything you put your mind to. Like, I know, again, it's cheesy, but it's cheesy because it's true. It's okay. Like Nico
said. Yeah.
But, because, I mean, yeah. I'm just some random kid who grew up in a third world country. And, you know, again, I'm still far from what I'd consider successful, but 20 years I've, you know, made quite some stuff like in the past 8 years. And, you know, it really is true. Like if you work hard and you believe in yourself and you're patient, I mean, you know, the boundaries are endless.
Yeah. I think that key word that you said is patience. And I think a lot of times we are rushing into this idea of like, okay, we want to be a photographer. Let's do this now. Let's, you know, blow up, but it takes time. And sometimes it was like baby steps of failure to see how we can like improve our work and like things like that. And like, it's that constant evolving of just creatively as a person and all of these, bringing down those stereotypes and just following your own path. And I think in this generation, we're slowly but surely working through like accepting that not everybody's path is going to be the same one. And like sometimes people are going to do things and others might not approve of it. But as long as you know that that's what's best for you, then that's all that really matters at the end of the day. And, you know, it's easier, you know, said than done. But like,
yeah, absolutely. And like what you said, like people want it now. Like that's, I think that's like another thing that, you know, social media has kind of like created to us is we're like, people want everything now. Cause like, you know, we, I mean, again, we can get everything on our fingertips instantly. Right. And, you know, like stuff with like careers, it takes time. It takes years and years and years and years. Yeah. And, you know, people want it today. Like they want that like short-term success. But like, if you really want to do something big and, you know, have success at like the biggest level, like you need to stay patient and, you know, play the long game basically.
Yep. I agree.
Which sometimes, you know, you're going to have to take a step back to take two steps forward, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And like, if you're thinking short-term, if you're always like, for example, in our line of work, I always tell people if I was in this for the money, I would still be shooting weddings because weddings pay the best.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to make films. So like, you know, I'm going to take that, like, let's say pay cut and work on stuff that I actually care about rather than, you know, shooting weddings and make much more money. Cause I know that in like 10, 20 years, it like that's going to pay off. Like you look at it almost as like an investment.
Yep.
Or like, okay, I'm going to take a step back now, but then in like 20 years, I'm going to be even, you know, further than I would have been if I continued doing this throughout the whole time.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I agree. And Aiden, Devin, do you guys have any thoughts about like, or want to add on to anybody comments about this? And like,
I relate to Callie with the Asian and like kind of like that kind of stereotypical group.
Mm-hmm.
But like personally, not only do I like look and like I notice like the problem, but I want to make a change to the problem, and that's kind of like what my future is and what I want to pursue. And that's like kind of recognizing everyone around the world and like how everyone's just the same and no one's like really like different just because the way they look, honestly, because everyone like lives in their communities, everyone like lives their life, like everyone's pretty much the same. And that's kind of how I want to like show the world through my storytelling and videography and cinematography, is like everyone's the same.
I agree. And then Devin, you had something to say.
Yeah, I completely agree with what you're saying. I think we need to change our idea of what's like normal, because like there really is no normal, whether that's be like your like appearance and what you look like Nico, I know, was saying, kind of referred to it earlier, but about fashion, like why do we gender clothes? Why can't guys wear nail polish? Why can't girls wear, you get the point, girls wear t-shirts, jeans, shorts, whatever else. I think we need to change what we see as being normal, because especially with social media, we've been talking about, you see these like big influencers and you think, oh, that's what I'm supposed to be, that's what I'm supposed to look like, but that's like, there is no normal. Like, you are you and you should go down your own path, because that's what's going to make you most successful.
Yep, no, I completely agree. Yes, and I'll snap to that too, because that is also very true. And like, just kind of defining your own path and just going with it. And, you know, people will agree and disagree, but at the end of the day, like I said, it's like, it's your work, your voice. Also, sorry for the noise. okay. But anyway.
Well, I kind of want to like add to what Devin said, because you mentioned fashion, and you know, I'm really into fashion and stuff. So I actually want to add on to the whole thing about like norms and the gender stuff. Like, I personally very comfortable in myself, my sexuality, my gender. But I personally think on some outfits, a pearl necklace looks really good. And so I bought a pearl necklace and I wear it with some outfits, and I received a lot of support. And I also received many people telling me that it's too feminine as a like a guy to wear. And I was like, that's so stupid. Like, I like it. I think it looks cool. And I think it looks great with this outfit. I'm going to wear it. And, you know, if you want to question me, go for it. I don't have to question myself. Like, I feel very comfortable in how I carry myself and what I am. And to me, this is nothing more than a necklace. And I think that I want to continue to break that, that norm. So, yeah.
I think, because it's you and it's time to shine. Life is too short, and like, do what you got to do to feel comfortable. But good for you. That's really cool though. And yes, pearl necklace does definitely look good on certain outfits.
For sure.
adding on to that, I think it's really interesting because we all use social media, and I think of it as a tool that can help us, you know, break out of boxes and break out of stereotypes. But I also think of it as a place where if there's a certain amount of negativity and a certain amount of, you know, like, I don't know, popular culture, I guess, it can also limit you and put you in a box and tell you what you're supposed to be and how your life is supposed to go. And so I think there's a really fine balance in using social media as a tool, because, you know, it's a great place to express your creativity and show the world how different and unique you are, but it also can lead to people thinking that, you know, this is the way you have to go about life. This is who you are supposed to be.
Yep, I completely agree. Does anybody else have another thought? I think, Hervoy, did you want to say something, or did I see the mic by accident?
No.
Okay. Well,
I think they covered it pretty well.
Yeah, they did. You guys really spoke honestly, truly, and just like from the heart. And I think that's what made this whole conversation so special. So thank you for that. But moving on to our last question now, what is your dream project? And we can start by Devin. What is your dream project? Like if you have one right now or like in the future.
I'd say shooting with some popular musician. I know that's not right now, but that's why it's a dream. So
yeah,
I think that'd be so cool, whether it be shooting album covers or even like for a magazine. I think that would be so cool because I'm not as into fashion as Nico is, but I've always loved that because it's a whole different realm of art. And I think music obviously is too. And I'm also very interested in most music. So I think that would be really cool.
That is really cool. And what about you, Aiden? What is your dream project, whether it be now or in the future?
So I've kind of mentioned it a couple of times already throughout the panel, but personally, it's exploring the world and making a movie or documentary or story just through the use of my filmmaking. But also another dream that I have or aspiration is to work with Paramount and be able to like be successful in the industry. Nothing really specific besides my goal of doing and exploring cultures, but that's pretty much it, I guess. I don't know.
No, that's super cool. Thank you for sharing that too. What about you, Hervoy? What is a dream project of yours?
I can't think of a singular project, but for me right now, like the goal is, I'm in a way kind of like living my dream right now because lately I've been getting more and more work and, you know, actually like in about 10 hours, it's 2 a.m. here right now, I'm going to be leaving for Dubrovnik where we're going to be shooting a feature for the next 2 weeks. And so yeah, it's basically that, just continuing to shoot features. I guess my dream would, like my biggest dream would be moving to the US finally and working on projects there as they are all on like a larger scale than they are over here. But yeah, that's pretty much about it.
Yeah, well, good luck moving, you know, back to the US in that transition. I'm sure that is challenging. But what about you?
I've never lived there.
Oh, really? You've never lived here before?
No.
Oh, my God.
It's been a lifelong dream.
Oh, my God.
I grew up in Austria, then moved to Bosnia and Herzegovina, where I spent, like, my middle school years. Now I'm in Croatia, and then, next stop is the U.S., hopefully.
Well, welcome to the U.S. whenever you come.
And thank you.
You're welcome. And, again, good luck with the move and, like, transitioning into that. But what about you, Kelly? What are some of your dreams?
You know, I really want to write a piece and shoot a piece for National Geographic. I mean, I've gotten subscriptions to their magazine since I was like 4. So I love their pieces and, you know, traveling and photography are two of my greatest passions. And so I'm really into photojournalism and documentary photography. And I would love to travel the world and, I don't know, document women. Or maybe go back to Taiwan, which is where my grandparents are from, and document our culture and way of life. And I think it'd be a really good way to also explore part of my identity as well.
That sounds like a super cool dream. And getting that exposure, like you said, like that space to kind of discover more of your identity. Well, good luck with that too. You're welcome. And lastly, what about you, Nico? What are some of your dreams?
God, I really don't know because it changes so much. But I think one really cool one, I don't even know because my mind changes a lot. But the first thing that comes to my head would be to like be able to work on a video with a very large budget. So like any piece of clothing that I could possibly imagine, like authentic 70s pants or like anything, you know, that that may be like just something where I can really like not have to be like, this will work kind of thing. Like I really, really want to have something where, you know, I have that exact piece of clothing. I would think that would be really cool.
Like that freedom of just be like, okay, this is what we're doing today.
Exactly. Like if I could just like snap my fingers and it like pops in front of me, that would be ideal.
Yeah. That is a goal. Well, I wish you all the best of luck with accomplishing your dreams and continue to be yourself along the way. And I want to thank you all again, our panelists, for sharing your experience, your knowledge, and your work with us. And thank you for our attendees for showing up for our youth and supporting us in all creative journeys. And before we sign off, we're going to hear from Luke, who is one of our Outside the Lens team members, about the way we can become a part of our, how you can become a part of our student stories. So thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Sienna. I'm really happy to be here with you guys. Wow, incredible stories from all of you. Quite a few of the people on the panel actually are part of our Youth Tellers program through Outside the Lens, which I just want to present really quick to you all. I saw in the comments, in the questions, that there were a lot of people interested in how can we get involved in these youth and their art, their lives, and kind of incorporating it with the older generation and everything. So we're really proud to announce Outside the Lens' newest program, Youth Tellers. Youth Tellers is a platform that shares and elevates stories by youth, with youth, and for youth. It's a time space where students discover ways of creating content for social impact, speaking to our present time, and shifting our vision for the collective future. We are creating a community where youth voices can be celebrated, uplifted, and heard in the media landscape. So what we're doing is all of this, we're doing it all virtually, and it's on an online-driven platform where students can create, submit, and share their work with the world using resources available on our Youth Tellers Discord. Students share their work with one another, giving and receiving feedback with peers. We also are providing access to learn Adobe Creative Suite via customized tutorials, which I think is just so cool, giving students all across the world access to that. But the area where Youth Tellers really shines is in its opportunity to provide mentorships from creative professionals like yourselves within the industry. Mentors will work with students on creating and achieving SMART goals for content deliverables, providing students the opportunity to take their content to the next level, which with these students, it's already pretty much there. But yeah, they're doing a great job. So here is a sample of all that Youth Tellers is about. It's a short video told from the perspective of our Tellers team. This video was student created 100% virtually. So please enjoy. It's from all over the world. Oh, I don't think we have sound.
Camera. Un escenario en el que usar mi voz. Un paintbrush. My pencil.
There are many ways to tell a story.
To capture a movement.
To stand for change.
This is a platform to do just that.
A place to learn.
To mentor.
To collaborate.
Shifting our vision for the collective future.
Made by youth.
With youth.
For youth.
I keep our summer school.
National President Team.
We are Youth Tellers.
That's great. So I'm going to wrap this up real quick. You saw a few familiar faces in that video. I put a link in the description or in the chat. So if you want to become a mentor, you can join us in that. So that's all I have for Youth Tellers. Here's a few examples of the projects they've been working on. But one more way to get involved with Outside the Lens that I would like to mention before we leave is our Creative Collective launch event. Outside the Lens is starting this collective group to create a space where our media professionals across every industry can come to learn from each other and network. Our first event is launching this coming week on September 17th from 5:30 to 7 p.m. So you can find the event on our Facebook under the events, or you can just click on the link in the chat that we dropped right there. So thank you all for coming. I'll send it back over to Sienna now, but again, congrats to our panelists. You guys did a fantastic job.
Thank you so much, Luke. Well, yeah, and then we'll wrap that up by, again, by saying thank you so much for being here to all our panelists and attendees. And to follow more of our student stories, here are all our social media handles, our Instagram, our Facebook, our YouTube, and Twitter and TikTok. But yeah, other than that, have a great weekend. And again, thank you so much for being here.